From the center of the universe, Toronto, Ontario, Canada, this is the SDM Show with your host, Rob Cairns. The SDM Show focuses on business, life, productivity, digital marketing, WordPress, and more. Sit back, relax, grab your favorite drink, and enjoy the show. Here is Rob.
Hey, everybody. I'm Rob Cairns. I'm the founder, CEO, and chief creator of Amazing Ideas at Stunning Digital Marketing. In today's podcast, I have my good friend and friend of the show, Todd Jones, with me, and we're going to talk about coaching and doing content. You really want to hear this discussion? Grab a drink, sit back, relax, enjoy the show. This podcast is sponsored by Stunning Digital Marketing, the agency that can help protect your WordPress website today. Go to stunningdigitalmarketing.com and see what we can do to help you protect your business investment. That's stunningdigitalmarketing.com. Hey, everybody, Rob Cairns here. And today I'm here with my good friend, Mr. Todd Jones, and friend of the show. How are you today, Todd?
I'm doing good. How about you?
Doing well for a lazy Thursday morning before doctor's appointments and more.
You're just butting your head against a brick wall, right?
Yeah, that too. Yeah. And it's overcast here in Toronto, so what can I say, you know?
So. Yeah, we're going to have some rain after a while. We had some really muggy weather yesterday afternoon. It was like, ugh. Anyway,
it's coming. So today I thought we'd talk about content coaching and some things you're working on. So how do you feel about that?
I like doing content coaching. You know, I was thinking about this before earlier. I'm probably a better strategist than I am a practitioner. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll see things from 30,000 feet, see trends, see what's going on. I'm really knee deep into the content and the copywriting industry, listening to what the top people are saying. And, and really a lot of people want to do the content themselves, or they have somebody in house, or they have a freelancer they use and that kind of thing. But maybe they're struggling with stuff, you know, having an issue with content not working, whatever. And that's where I like to come in and say, see what it's like a QA almost, really. You're kind of doing quality assurance, but you're kind of coming in and diagnosing where problems could be. And, you know, there's no need, you know, I've had a lot of people come to me for like a website copyright, and really they don't need to rewrite the copy, the whole website. Sometimes they just need to work on a certain area, and improve that. So, you know, you're best to talk to somebody who can tell you that up front before you like invest a lot of money in a whole website rewrite. But I also get that too, because I'm going through changes, evolution in what I do. And it's like, well, I have to go and redo my website, like, you know, what I say on it. So, I kind of like the whole looking at the big picture and, you know, analyzing areas that could be tweaked and improving content. So that's kind of that's a sweet spot for me, I guess.
I would agree. And I hate to go here, but we have to. And I think you know where I'm going to go, because there's two dreaded letters in this business called AI. Those two dreaded letters.
And how much time do you have?
Lots.
How much time do you have?
I think we can't have a content discussion without involving AI. That's just a reality in today's world. And I think you and I have talked about offline many a conversation. We've said
we had a conversation on here about it one time.
Yeah, AI is just a tool, and AI doesn't make you a better writer, and you still need strategy and you still need coaching. What do you think?
Yeah, that sounds right. you know, and you might be, some people who's listening might be surprised to hear, and because I listen to a lot of what content writers say, most of us are in some kind of AI tool every single day. We just are. There's so much you can do with AI, from research or mostly evaluation. Like I was playing around a few weeks ago, Rob, with, you know, using my About Page framework, can I get ChatGPT or Gemini to evaluate like an About Page, a currently written About Page using my framework? And I was really close to doing that. What I realized, it was not going to, you can't just dump it all in there and expect to do, if that's too much, you got to like go one section at a time. Okay, here's the first section. Here's what I'm looking for. How does it fare? And let it do that. You can do some evaluations with AI. You can do a whole lot of, not so much AI, not so much research, but you can do some analysis of research, putting CSV files in and so forth. There's a lot of that kind of stuff you can do with AI. And I saw somebody say, I've actually heard a couple of people say this, we will probably never start with a blank draft again with AI. I'm not quite there yet because I still have like certain things in my head. Sometimes it's there, but it's cloudy. So I have to start writing to get it out. But boy, you can, you know, little technical things you can do pretty quick with AI, or, you know, especially ChatGPT and Gemini, but you've got to give it the info. You know, if you're expecting it to go out and get the info, you run into one of two problems. One, the info might be wrong. You know, you just might be wrong because, you know, and both ChatGPT and Gemini have a notice down there saying, check the information because it's not always right. So that's your first clue. Don't go out and get the information. You input the information. Number two, if you're asking it just to spin up something, it very well might plagiarize. I mean, it's copying from somewhere, right? So it might pull content or copy from something that already exists, and suddenly, and if you're putting that out there, you're publishing a book using it or whatever, and you haven't like gone through that, you put yourself in a liability situation. You might be plagiarizing somebody's work. You got to be careful about using AI that way. I say don't write an entire piece of content with AI. AI is great for helping you smooth off the rough edges. If your writing is a little bit, maybe you write how you talk and a little bit more than maybe you should, and you need to clean that up a little bit. You need a confident but casual tone, those kinds of things. AI can help. The good ones can. Now, there's several tools, obviously. I haven't played with all of them, but one I'm familiar with is Content to Scale, I think is what it's called. Julia McCoy is over there, and I saw loosely a demo, I should say. It was really a webinar, but they got into it and showed how it could be done. And it has some real promise, I believe. But it's not going to spin it up out of thin air for you. You have to train it in your style of writing. And then you input all the stuff, and then it spins it like you write it. I shouldn't say spin. It writes it like you write it. So it allows, like, if you've got a content team of, say, three writers, and you've got to populate all this content across multiple, you know, spots, you could write, you know, the topic can change. You put the information in, and it'll write like one of your writers. So you kind of keep the tone and, you know, voice and all that kind of stuff. That's some real promise, I think, for the future for content production. So, but one thing you run into with AI, I think, is that I'm starting to use the word remarkable content, because it tells me that you're rising above the fray. So for many, many years now, we have been using what I would call informational or educational content, which is fine. But this, like, that's all it is. It's straight educational, straight emotion, educational, straight informational content, without thinking about certain things that make content better and more engaging. And a lot of that is because companies are putting out multiple pieces of content a day, trying to dominate SEO through putting out, they're trying to saturate it to dominate the SEO. So all this content, I'm gonna say all of it, a lot of it is very meh, is baseline. It's good, but it's not great, you know, that kind of thing. AI is going to speed that up. So that SWOT that we already have, that Mark Schaefer called content shock 10 years ago, is going to get wider, more of it. And I think we're running into a crossroads, really, between that and the fact that consumers consume content differently than they did 12, 15 years ago. True. When much of what we were doing was a novelty, right? It was like, oh, here's an ebook that'll tell me how to do this or that. Let me download it. And then suddenly I'm on email list. I'm getting emails, I'm getting blog posts and all this kind of stuff. And it's a novelty. And I'm like, you're doing this. 15 years later, it's not a novelty anymore. Consumers, both B2B and B2C, they've been there, done that now for 15 years. What was it, 2007, 2008, that Marketo and HubSpot launched? And they basically had the same idea, right? It's content marketing kind of deal. Even the guy who founded Marketo has come out and said, we can't do it like we were doing it in 2008 through 2015. That whole, it was going so well because people just aren't, they're not downloading downloadables anymore. They're not, they're not going to read meh content anymore. You've really got to do something to get their attention. You got to have what I would call remarkable content. So I've been working on what the characteristics of remarkable content is in my own time, trying to build somewhat of a blueprint. There's another, I think going forward, especially if you're not doing gobs of content, you should have remarkable content as much as you can. That doesn't mean every piece of content should be remarkable. My friend Steve Roller, which I think you know, he likes to talk about something called black box content. Yeah. It's really a metaphor for what I would call signature content. It's what you're known for. It's the identity, the content that identifies with you. So, for example, to your users, the SDM show is signature content for Rob Cairns. You don't really write blog posts anymore. You do podcasts. That's what you do. You get smart people on your podcast. You interview them. It's like a masterclass. And that would be a piece of signature content for Rob Cairns. So that's a good example of what I call signature content. But you gotta produce your signature content. You gotta produce your remarkable content. And then another piece of content that I think overlaps all of that. I was sitting in a webinar with Smarty Marketing yesterday that I've kind of gotten to know those people pretty well. They're really, for lack of better terms, an SEO agency, but they do something that they call link-worthy content. And it's not a new concept, but they kind of pioneered it like years ago, 10, 12 years ago, the idea of linkable or link-worthy content. It's content that gets a lot of links because backlinks are still important in the world of Google. So I think you've got to create linkable content, but you got to create remarkable content, I think. And so what I say is create content worth sharing. It is just so, different, so out of this world, that it's so remarkable that it's worth sharing. And then, of course, when you do that, links come, right? So you're not really even doing it for SEO's sake, but it should actually help your SEO.
We always talk about in the marketing space, should you create content for SEO or should you create content for the reader? What is your feeling on how we should create content?
Reader first.
Okay.
You've had her on, Maddie Osmond, for her book. I think she wrote a very good book. If you're doing any kind of content on a regular basis, two books should be on your desk, in my opinion. Maddie's book, Writing for Humans and Robots, how she frames it. And the second one is Everybody Writes by Anne Hanley. Those two
books. And they're both on my desk.
Yeah. And yeah, exactly. And but you write for the, I mean, this is something we actually knew is coming, right? The state of 2024. And then Google is trying to change stuff right now, and it's kind of a hot mess. So, like, for instance, Lily Ray, the SEO expert that I like to follow on Twitter, who's a DJ by night. So I find her a very intriguing character. She was posting or retweeted something somebody else said, and the phrase in Google was how to spot the signs of breast cancer or something like that. And the first three things were Quora and Reddit. Not exactly where you want to go. You know, that's the SGE, right? The search engine generated, whatever it's called, the little thing at the top that Google's starting to give for answers, quick answers. And they're putting up Quora and Reddit. So you've got to stop worrying so much about Google right now, because they're kind of going through they're making some massive changes. Some of it's for the better. And some of it's, you know, they're like in the teenage years right now. You know, they're having trouble with their results. They're trying to straighten out stuff. A lot of people have seen their rankings tank or their traffic tank because Google made some kind of adjustment in the last content update. So you're better off writing for humans. And, you know, that comes with the formatting, the grammar, all the stuff that Maddie talks about in her book. But it also comes with creating remarkable content. And which, you know, kind of goes above the fray. There's a lot of characteristics of that. I didn't pull that up before we got on. That's what I should have done. But things like having a subject matter expert in your content, engaging content, various types of engaging content, using storytelling. I like to talk about the REO framework, relevant, engaging, and original. And with original is an original angle on a topic, because most topics have been discussed at this point, right? So have an original angle, original opinion, and original research. Those three things would, you know, are things that will drive that content. So if you do that and you work at it and you get better, you will create what I think is content that's remarkable and worth sharing. And sharing is where you can break through all that SEO stuff. Now, there's another thing happening in the marketing space right now that is changing all this. The algorithms, I call them the algo gods, the other algo, I'm drawing a blank right now. Don't you love it when you're on a live show and draw a blank? But anyway, it's harder and harder because it costs more to do what you used to do, that kind of thing. So what's happening is especially at the top of the marketing channels, right? The top marketers are saying, we've got to go back to using brand awareness. This is where remarkable content can help you create that brand awareness. We're running into issues with Google, not sure what it wants to do, and the social media algorithms, not sure what it wants to do, and it's suppressing organic content, and you're paying more to boost content on social media. You're paying more to get content distributed out there. So the cost for the reach has gone up quite a bit. If you can create remarkable content and distribute it well, there's a book that just came out by Ross Simmons that I highly recommend people get. It's called Create Once, Distribute Forever. The idea of distributing, you have to reformat. You have to take the content, because these days to really be successful, especially organically, is you almost have to reformat stuff. You can't just put a bland post up anymore. It's not going to go anywhere. You've got to drop a video in. You got to drop, you know, a funny sketch. There's a guy I watch almost every Friday named Chris Bogue, I think is his name. Some of the funniest stuff I've ever seen. He has this one he does once or twice a month called Death by PowerPoint. And it's a webinar, I guess. I don't know what you call it. He's really an improv comedian by a trade doing marketing. And so we get in there and he gets three volunteers and they don't know what the PowerPoint's going to say. And they have to improv through the PowerPoint. It is hilarious. Some of the stuff the guys come up with. And I laugh and I tell Chris, I said, this is the best webinar I've ever been to in my life. It's funny and engaging.
Yeah. And I want to throw one more book out there while we're talking about books, is our good friend Andy Crescendo's book about Content Creator's Handbook. Yeah. I mean, it sits on my nightstand every night, and it's designed not to be read. And Andy will tell you that.
Yeah,
but it's designed as a reference guide. And I think it is the best all-inclusive reference guide out there. And by the way, if you're not following Andy on LinkedIn, go look him up because he's worth every dime. And the other guy that I think is really good around this whole content strategy is David Gearhart, who's now running Exit 5 and has been with a multitude of startups. I think David does a really good job running talking about content as well.
Well, if you're going to throw David out, we'll throw Spark Turrell out. And Amanda, I can never say her name right. Navid or something like that. Anyway, she's highly engaging. And she put a post on LinkedIn, which was meant to be funny, but it got so much traction because we were all commenting, right? And so it was like, I can't even, there was a feature on LinkedIn, and both her and David had them turned on where you pretty much had to know the email address to connect with them. So she said, I can't even connect with Dave Gearhart because of this feature. And everybody starts talking about, how funny it is, whatnot. And they're laughing. And we should have actually, all I had to do was email you. And I said, and weren't you on his podcast? Maybe it was David that said that. I don't know. Anyways, it was funny. They couldn't connect on LinkedIn, even though they knew each other, like you and I, because they had both had the feature turned on. They had to use the right email address or something. I don't know. I think they've since left that rule. But that turned into a very engaging post. And it had nothing to really, very little to do with business. But Dave is a super sharp guy. I listen to him all the time. I'll say this about Andy. His articles, the articles that they do at Orbit Media, which is a web-based company. I mean, they do websites. That's what they do for a living. He is the best content marketer in the web space, bar none, in my opinion. The articles are incredible. But they're very practitioner. He admitted that. There's not a lot of aspirational stuff in there, but it's very practitioner type articles. And he used yours truly as a subject matter expert in one of his articles. So that was kind of cool. And he's a good guy.
Yes. So let's get back to coaching for a sec. So if you were starting off with somebody new in the B2B space and you had three suggestions you could give them to win with their content right away. Can you give them, please?
Oh, right away. Well, I'm still big on building your brand, so you can build brand awareness. That's like foundational.
Personal or business brand or both?
It depends on your company. If your company is tied around you, like for instance, you're studying digital marketing, but everybody knows it's Rob Cairns. So you building a personal brand is probably going to help your business. Now, if you're an expert in the field for many, many years, but you're at a company and you think maybe one day you might, be on your own or have your own deal like Dave did. Dave Gearhart worked at two or three big, he was CMO for large companies, but he built his brand on the side. Now, if you think you're going to die with the company, in other words, you're going to stay there till the end. As long as the company's doing well, you build the company. It really doesn't matter. When you talk about personal brand, there's a whole lot of authority building with that. It's like you got to prove that you're an authority, and there's other stuff about that. But if you're talking about making quick gains, I would help people build we would talk about, can we build a link-worthy, remarkable piece of content that can be put on their article, put on their website quickly. So that will help with the brand awareness. And now I still think, all the things that you need to do in a brand awareness. So, and I say this, I've always said about page is a mini brand story. Well, forget that. It just is a brand story. It is a brand story for you as a person or your company. Your about page is that crucial. All the things you have to do to create a good about page, like what is your target audience, what is your differentiation? Those kind of things are going to help immensely with building the content, like a link-worthy asset or something like that. The other thing I would consider doing is helping somebody come up with something consistent that would be known as their signature content. So for you, you've already done the STM show. That's in place. That don't stop. But somebody new, okay, do you want to do a podcast? You want to do... you know, how do we make it uniquely yours if it is a podcast? It's funny because all the podcast coaches out there are still saying there's a lot of podcasts, but there's still room for more, which kind of blows my mind. But if they're saying that, maybe there is. But, you know, come up with something, a unique format. You know, podcasting may not be your thing. You may not like talking on audio. So maybe there's something else you can do. Maybe you have some really good design chops. Well, let's see what we can do with that. You know, it kind of depends on the content you're trying to put out there. So I have started something on LinkedIn, and, you know, I'm trying to make myself keep doing it. It's called Storytime. Storytime with Todd E. Jones. And there, these are little like 5 minute or less videos I put on LinkedIn. I've done 3 of them now, I believe. And, you know, I've gotten some response from them. But, you know, I'm trying to connect myself with content that storytelling base. And so, you know, we'll see. obviously website copy framework is something I'm known for. But yeah, probably just quick wins is like, let's find some kind of Lynch worthy asset you can build. Now that will take some time to create, but, and probably a one-off unless you can do something consistently. Okay. We're going to do this every Thursday for, you know, whatever. So that's probably what, but what I would probably do if they're approached me the first time, it's like, what is it you want to work on? I don't even like to use the word coaching, to be honest with you, Rob, but that's really what it is. I feel like a coach has to have credentials and all that kind of stuff. Okay, my credentials is doing this for 15 years. How about that? In touching every part of the funnel along the way.
I agree with that comment about credentials. Not to cut you short, I think a lot of people look for credentials because they don't know what to ask for. So it's easier to say, do you have ABC letters after your name? And you take somebody like myself, I always joke, and people, you know, you see my email signature, it's pretty basic until I'm pissed off. And then I have an email signature that's got 3 lines of credentials on it. Oh. And honestly, credentials only matter for, as far as I'm concerned, for the HR department and the uneducated people. The average person would rather getting somebody who can do it than is certified to the nines, right?
Let me just say, I think there are some areas in which when you're a coach, you should have credentials if you're doing certain things. And because I actually have a friend, and I don't know that he does much of it anymore. He's more of an operationals consultant. But he had coaching credentials, and it was kind of a life credential, life coaching deal, and all that kind of stuff. Like, you don't want somebody willy-nilly doing life coaching for you. If they're a therapist or something like that, if it's getting the therapy or certain areas where there's a lot of regulations, for instance, financial planning, you don't want some Joe doing financial planning. I'm going to go see Brian, the guy that does financial planning for my entire family, who's been doing this for 30 years.
But for financial planning, I agree with you. You need to be certified. But then my question would be, what have you done with your own portfolio? What have you done with own finances? Because here's the problem with credentials. A lot of guys get credentialed on paper.
Oh, sure.
But when it comes to reality experience, they know SFM.
Notice I said about Brian, he's been doing this for 30 years, and he does it for my entire family, my brother and my mom. So while I don't look at the charts and whatnot, I know he's taking care of my mom because he meets with her once a year. I mean, and you know, so I know there's a personal experience there. I know that Brian can do that, and I'm fine. But I don't even ask what his credentials is really at this point. I just assume at this point he's been in the game long enough. He had to have some kind of credentials to get there. There are just certain industries, I think, as a coach, you probably need to have some kind of credentials and the experience and success that you talk about. Unfortunately, maybe 10, 15 years ago, I should have done the HubSpot certifications, but I didn't. Maybe that would give me a little bit more social proof. But anyway.
So moving on a little bit, we've talked about some things that you should do. What is the number one thing if you're coaching somebody, you tell them not to do with the content?
Be meh. Be bland. write too corporate-y and too much jargon. Mm-hmm. Write everything straight up from AI. I'm not going to tell somebody don't use AI, just more or less use it as a tool, not to completely generate your content. I kind of have benchmarks, kind of things, guardrails, if you will, that I view as, good content. And it's come over a period of time. I mean, I can remember I used to go to Tutorial Tuesday by Copy Hackers, and she's this, I call her the queen of conversion copywriting, Joanna Weeb. She's a Canadian, so she must be okay, right? She told how they did their blog posts at Copy Hackers, and it literally blew my mind. It's like, that's a lot of work to do that these agencies who are doing 20 content pieces a week are never going to do. And as a result, she said, we don't focus on SEO, but our stuff just ranks well. She was really, if you will, doing a very authoritative, human-driven content on their blog post that ranked really well without them really focusing on SEO too much. I'm sure they had all the technical things in place, structure-wise on the website, but it became an authority. And so you got to give her and her team a lot of credit for that. And so that kind of like started getting me to think about what is good content. I've since added to that. I think that more engaging content is, dealing with sensory language, getting people to feel. If you can write a piece of content that gets somebody to run through a wall, then it's like they listen to a Dusty Rhodes promo called Hard Times in 1985. And I don't think content gets people to feel enough. And
emotion in marketing is everything.
Yeah, it's a huge part. In fact, I was listening to a short section, I think it was Dave at Gerhard actually, talking to Talia Wolf, who's I call her the conversion rate optimization queen. She was talking and she's big on using emotions. That's kind of been her calling card. She said there's studies that actually show that in B2B marketing, emotions are even more important, which is astonishing. She says, now, it has to do with what is going to connect for the individual person. So it may not necessarily be the needs of the company. It may be like, okay, this makes me look better as an employee because I saved us money by doing this or whatever. But not necessarily. It's fascinating.
But sometimes it's little things. Like I've had multiple comments. Regular listeners and viewers of this podcast will know I dedicate this podcast to my late father at the end of every episode. Yep. And I've had multiple people over the years come back and say that touches them and they can relate. So half the thing about emotion is being able to relate to what somebody is feeling. And I think as marketers, too many marketers are too bland and they don't pull on emotion. And that's a big of an issue.
Boring. They're just very boring. And right now, go ahead and stay boring, but it's bold to do this, right? So if you come to me and I'm saying, okay, you need to do this, I'm probably going to get pushback. Like, no, that's just too much. That's too much this, too much emotion, whatever. Yeah, I get that. So it takes some, courage to do some of this stuff, to be bold, to put yourself out there, to do something so unique that has never been done before. And, I would love to do that with some origin stories. So if anybody wants to do an origin story and we want to do something unique and out of this world, let me know. We'll do something. I feel like origin stories read like a boring sales letter and less like a Netflix documentary or a Netflix series. Let's see if we can get origin stories to be more like the Netflix series. I'm going through the narco series right now. I'm in the Mexico one. I mean, it just pulls you along. But I think some people think that's emotional manipulation. I think you're just tapping into something. The thing about your dad is this, and there's both Kinder Hall and Karen Eber talk about it in their book, but you talk about your dad. So when somebody listens, you're talking to them, I'm dead against my dad, blah, blah, blah. then somebody hears that and they remember their dad. And yeah. if it's good memories like you have, then it's going to really resonate deeply. It's a little thing. What I learned in storytelling from Kendra's book is you don't necessarily have to give all the details. You guys got to give enough because our brains will fill in the details with our own life. It yeah. is very powerful. So just you saying that little blurb at the end, I dedicate this to my late father, that fills in the details for somebody else. It's like, oh, yeah, I do a lot of things. I think about my father. So, yeah, I can definitely see that.
I agree. It's been great conversation. If somebody wants to talk to you about coaching, how is the best way or some help?
Well, copywriting.com. I think I have a page for that. Hold on. Let me just check real quick. Because you can do one directly for your about page. That's something that is a I think I have a coaching page, but I can't figure out where it's at. but you can do the about page coaching and on the homepage at the very top, it's got web service, web copywriting and about page services. I think both of those links have a coaching page on there, but I probably should get my coaching page somewhere where people can find it a little bit easier. But yeah, you can go to copyflight.com and you can send a message to the form. I send you a Stripe link and we'll get started. You can do one of two ways, one-on-one coaching for content. We can meet in person like you and I are doing right now for an hour or whatever and discuss whatever you want to talk about. Or you can do an asynchronous, which is something I'm experimenting with. Instead of meeting one-to-one at the same time, you send me like, okay, this is a piece of content I want to work on, or this is what I have a question about. And I reply with an email video, like a Loom video or something like that, give you my thoughts. And we can carry that conversation on, for a couple of times. And that's an asynchronous coaching. So it's a little bit different than the one-to-one. It's there's a little bit less time involved in terms of, well, there's, you don't have to like meet at the same time. So I kind of keep that cost a little bit lower. So it's a great way to try out if I'm somebody that you can use a little bit less cost. So
thanks, Todd, and have yourself an awesome day, my friend, as always.
Thank you. Have a good one.
This show is brought to you by stunningdigitalmarketing.com, your Toronto leader in digital marketing services. Not only do we protect your WordPress website, we can help you with your site, provide social media management for your business, or even do one-on-one consulting. To find out more, go to stunningdigitalmarketing.com. A very special thank you to Todd Jones for joining me on this edition of the SDM Show. Hey, everybody, Rob here again. Thanks for listening to the SDM Show. It's such a pleasure to have you every week. If you want more on our agency website, go to stunningdigitalmarketing.com. We are your WordPress security experts. We'd be glad to help you out. If you want to learn more about me, Rob Cairns, go to meetrobcairns.online. From there, you can find links to everything I do on the web, as well as book time with me, so feel free. If you want to make comments about this podcast or know a guest possibly suitable for the podcast, please email us at podcast@stunningdigitalmarketing.com. Or conversely, you can go to X, formerly known as Twitter, and tweet at me at Rob Cairns. This podcast is dedicated to my late father, Bruce Cairns. Dad, I miss you very much, and I love you. Please join us next week for another interesting podcast and have a great week, everybody. Bye for now.